morning, everyone. I am Rennie Hyde, one of last year's Masters of Ceremony.
And I'm Kai Watts, also one of the Masters of Ceremony from last year.
Today, we have the honor of reading the names of our 2022 Decatur Bulldogs.
Families and friends, before we begin, remember to silence all cell phones and let's hold applause until the end in order to honor all of our students. Mustafa Abdulman.
Habiba Abshiro.
Gabrielle Adams.
Kinsley Adams.
Liam Bacon.
Callie Allendete.
Ben Allerspires.
William Allen.
Anna Anderson.
Sage Arnold.
Taylor Arnold.
Lily Ash.
Parker Axon.
Benjamin Bailey.
Kieran Bailey.
Diana Bahala.
Clara Balka.
Yana Batra.
Lula Malacano.
Grayson Bauer.
Frank Battle.
Max B. Lindgren.
A.M. Slade Barrett.
Devin Bell.
Isabella Mason.
Jaden Bell.
Griffin Bell.
William Bellinger Neff.
Paris Bell.
Jay Bearhold.
Grayson Bennett.
Beau Blanchard.
Daniel Blake.
Quincy Booth.
Declan Bolt.
Ian Boswell.
Miranda Bordland.
Will Brady.
Hunter Boyer.
Naomi Bridgers.
Clara Brand.
Guy Brill.
Naomi Bridges.
Ethan Broom.
Gemma Brooks.
Sophia Bittner.
Elijah Brooks.
Steve Butterfield.
George Burnett.
Jamethia Caldwell.
Maxie Cabrera-Wiser.
Chase Carpenter.
Adam Campbell.
Bailey Carr.
Hayden Carpenter.
Chloe Kadenak.
Solomon Carr.
Tyreek.
Karina Chamblin.
Hannah Choi.
Hamadi.
Jahari Sintron.
Benjamin Clark.
Fearless Clark.
Quincy Clark.
Eleanor Cleveland.
Connor Coltrane.
Madeline Coleman.
Thomas Cook.
Parker Condon.
Emily Cox.
Jacob Cooper.
Lauren Cox.
Joey Costello.
Caroline Crispino.
Leah Cosworth.
Sean Dallahan.
Grant Cromwell.
Alex Sadie.
Alexandria Dabney.
Nina DiFilippo.
Charlie Daniel.
Isha Desai.
Antonio Dawson.
Matthias Everett.
Sam Delisle.
Niall Diller.
Kaya Desai.
Delaney Duggan.
Cole Dixon.
Evan Ibrahimi.
Ella Didmer.
Alice Emerson.
Sequoia Dudley.
Stella Esposito Gooden.
Jaden Illy Williams.
Juliana Finnemore.
Luca Elliott.
Ethan Fisk.
Sophia Epley.
Helena Florence.
Shamaya Evans.
Chloe Foster.
Katrina Fiedler.
Wesley Freeland.
Camden Flynn.
Reese Freireich.
Kara Flowers.
Joseph Gable.
LeBron Foy.
Flynn Gannon.
Kenya Freeman.
Gershi.
Omar Frywell.
Jordan Gilly.
Daniel Gamba.
Christian Gonzalez.
Ben Gatchell.
Jada Gonzalez.
Mazzy Gibbons.
Harrison Goodman Cohn.
Noah Glasgow.
Rome Gordon.
Jacob Gonzalez.
Ava Gowdy.
Bridget Goodman.
Juliet Graff.
Braden Gordon. Maya Gorin.
Garrett Gutcher.
Anais Graff.
Audrey Hagberg.
Katie Gunther.
Eric Hansen.
Evan Guzman.
Sarah Harper.
Tate Hammett.
Emma Hatch.
Lyle Hardison.
Josh Heff.
Sophia Hart.
Galvin Hiramar.
Claire Hedges.
Ben Hicks.
Grant Heifetz.
Robin Hill.
Sarah Hireman.
Jason Manson. Hansen.
Evelyn Higdon, sorry.
Ken Holmes.
Parker Hills.
Thomas Horton.
Sophia Holland.
Dorsey Howard.
Gemma Hofetter.
Sean Irons.
Michaela Hurdle.
Michael Jackson.
Keiko Ito.
Brooke Jansen.
Torrance Jackson.
Robert Jeffrey.
Demi Jardine.
Colin Jezerowski.
Isaiah Jenkins.
Tyler Johnson.
Miles Johnson.
Catherine Jones.
Brady Jones.
Mara Jones.
Jasmine Jones.
Zoe Jones.
Nelson Jones.
Ethan Joyce.
Caroline Jordan.
Sasha Calarico.
Noah Julian.
Francis Kerr.
Nikhil Corcoran.
James King.
Owen Kelly.
Jacob Kosky.
Molly Kayad.
Adina Lambusher.
Owen King.
Aaron Lamb.
Taylor Kyle.
Teo Laura.
Emma Lagon.
Ivy Leach.
Owen Lambert.
Oliver Lee.
Andrew Leus.
Corey Lee.
Jacob Levy.
Makai Lloyd.
Henry Lemon.
India Lumpkin.
Nia Lovern.
Dominic Mariani.
Andrew McIntosh.
Brooklyn Martinez.
Jeffrey Markowitz.
Riley May.
Priyanka Master.
Stephen McClellan.
Macy McLaren.
Sophia McDaniel.
Noe McCurry.
Mae McNally.
Sophie McGuire.
Maxwell Mendoza.
Finn McWhorter.
Simone Mayer.
Camille Messonnier.
Charlie Miller.
Max Middlecoff.
Jessica Montgomery.
Hanad Mohammed.
Roxanne Morgan Maxfield.
Jeremiah Mooney.
Margo Merwick.
Sarah Moss.
Charlie Mueller.
Issa Mucha.
Nia Mullins.
Zoe Wheeler. Mueller.
Zuri Merck. Avery Myers.
Raphael Mulligan.
Rosa Natsunagara.
Zenobia Mustafa.
Nicole Nicholas Little. Nagusa Little.
Sam Namias.
Elsie Nana.
Michaela Nathaniel.
Elliot Nicoletti.
Griffin Nelms.
Luke Novak.
Wanyan Nguyen.
Sham O'Connor.
Naomi Norton.
Natalie Park.
Eleanor Nelman.
Asha Osman.
Quinn O'Keefe.
Maria Pate.
Grace Osborne.
Sam Payman.
Jason Park.
James Pena.
Ford Parler.
Sophie Pearson.
Aiden Payne.
Gabriel Peterson.
Christopher Perry.
Ava Piper.
Jack Peters.
Santiago Pulitzer.
Myra Phelps.
Tatum Powell.
Joe Pittman.
Charles Price.
Francesca Porcelli.
Jacob Rachel.
Sophie Powell.
Jackson Reynolds. Diogo Richardson.
Ian Preston Hudson.
Morgan Roche.
Quincy Pritchard.
Ellie Rodriguez.
Rylan Rippard.
Dinah Rogers.
Trevor Rice.
Nathan Ruark.
Elijah Richardson.
Gabriella Salazar.
Dorothy Rohde.
Christopher Sanders.
Aiden Rogers.
Ben Saracen.
Sophia Rose.
Lillian Sayers.
Ryan Russell.
Jacob Schneider.
Sydney Salcedo.
Grayson Schwab.
Keon Sanavandi.
Raina Scott.
Christian Sanford.
Alta Sewell.
Zoe Saul.
Harrison Schaefer.
Sam Schecksnyder.
Sarah Shelby. Samantha Simonette.
Charlotte Schrimmel.
Jacob Scott.
Micah Scott.
Carter Smith.
Carter Simrad.
Danielle Smith.
Yasmeen Shad.
Caitlin Smith.
William Shea.
Nashawn Smith.
Brandy Shepherd.
Molly Ann Sulin.
Kathleen Seiler.
Mary Spinner.
Lewis Sinclair.
Jeremy Snedder.
Alexander Sloop.
Noah Stokey.
Chapman Smith.
Yusha Syed.
Gabriel Smith.
Isabel Taggart.
Solomon Kane Smith.
Luke Taylor.
Sean Spears.
Maddox Thomas.
Dahlia Spinrad.
Josie Tipton.
Dannon Stewart.
Anissa Trevilian.
Finn Swanson.
Kagan Travis.
Anna Taggart.
Devontae Tribes.
Charlotte Taylor.
Tyler Truitt.
Vanessa Taylor.
Nikos Verlinden.
Miles Thompson.
Lillian Farron.
Adrian Turavanzu.
Anna Villavaca.
David Trevilian.
Sophia Walker.
James Tribe.
Parker Ware.
Isaiah Triplett.
Levi Waterhouse.
Max Tyler.
Benjamin Weiser.
Ethan Vanderendy.
Mary Whiteman.
Krish Verma.
Emily Williams.
Griffin Vickery.
Sydney Williams.
Zoe Wakefield.
Cameron Wingo.
Bryn Wansley.
Hamid Wood.
Jacaney Washington.
Trey White.
Audrey Watson.
Jonah Werfel.
Joseph Whiteley.
Shangmin Yan.
Ivy Wildman.
Sultan Zia.
Catherine Williams.
Kelly Zrelaw.
Avery Wilson. Lydia Witter. Ivy Wren Davis. Miles Wright. Jeffrey Yan. Sarah Yates. Kai Zakovic.
Thank you. name is Sophia Walker.
And I'm Sydney Williams.
Welcome to Renfroe Middle School's 8th grade Capstone Celebration. Families, teachers, and friends, we are all here today to honor our class of students and to celebrate this moment in their lives. Now we will hear Ivy Wildman's beautiful violin solo, Concerto in G Major. Tears, applause, and chaos that is to come.
Let's think. What is happening this year that has prompted students to take action?
Our theme this year was inspired by the many students who stood up for what they believed in, becoming unlikely heroes for others and even for themselves. This year, we redefined what hero means to all of us.
To start reflecting upon our middle school years, we first have to turn inward. Now we will hear from Raina Scott, Beau Blanchard, and Roxy Morgan Maxfield, followed by a performance of Landslide by Mary Spinner and Kayla Nicole.
I used to think that this was it. The United States was where it was all at. It was the center of the earth, the buzzing capital of the world. It had to be. Because I was here. Whether this thought had formed in my head from the countless one-sided stories of the New World, or years of learning about one country and 196, it created an image that was partial and affected how I thought about the people around me. If the long hours of interaction and conversation just in middle school have taught me anything, it's that we are not alone. In fact, we're the opposite. Our Earth is overflowing with 7.6 billion people, and they all have their own interpretations of the world. Every person has a light as complete and profound as our own. A light blinking miles away in a window has experiences that are not only vastly similar, but also drastically uncomparable to mine. A political debate has dozens of angles while pleading to be discovered. A boy in Japan believes Tokyo is a meeting place of all our stories, simply because he was born there. Everyone narrates an invisible story. It is when we walk a mile in shoes unfamiliar to us that we shed light on another version of thinking. Walking through the rusted doors of Renfroe Middle School in my sixth grade year, I definitely did not realize the capacity of my peers' emotions. I did not realize the people around me who flourish and fail do so as vibrantly as I do. Then, when my friends recounted their tales of drama and dread, it became easier for me to empathize with them. If someone told me of a time they felt like they were standing at the top of the world, I could feel the wind blow on my face. Or if someone told me of a time that they felt insulted or attacked, I could feel the anger boiling in my stomach and the heat grow under my cheeks. I started to feel for the unnoticed and the silent. They lived a whole life that I wasn't living, one that none of us got to see. And instead of exploring it, we ignored it. I began to analyze the faces I saw every day and think deeper about the words that I heard. I tried to consider every way of looking at a situation, and I tried to see things from 1,000 different views, all to better my understanding of the people that walk the same halls that I do. People are labeled as kind often, and this is only because they dare to venture outside of their own world. It shouldn't be unique to lend someone in need a hand. I help with the kid that got pummeled in the hall because I can imagine how that hurts, even though it hasn't happened to me. I say, "How are you?" or lend a dollar to a homeless man because I know sleeping in the rain cannot be easy. The refugees across the seas are just stories until you think about what life looks like from their eyes. And then they turn into real people with real lives who breathe the same air that we do. They just happen to be gasping for more room to breathe. The most valuable thing I've learned these past few years is that in every person I meet, there's a whole new story. Because of this, I cannot be too quick to assume. And I have learned that I cannot let my actions towards people be based on my assumptions of them. I still work hard every second of the day to have an open mind with every person I see and every news line I read. There is so much this world can offer you, the good along with the bad. So I dare you, the next time you want to believe that someone else's problems aren't important, or you see someone who walks or talks different than you, explore the unknown, try to release your mind, open up your curtains, dust out your cobwebs, and let the sun shine in. Thank you.
Originally, I was going to write my capstone on how much I love my mom. She always makes me watch the news, and because of that, I've grown to be more aware of the events happening around me, in my community, and my country. Movements like Black Lives Matter, Me Too, and March for Our Lives have opened my eyes to a new perspective of my own world, the city of Decatur. As a young boy, these issues were too hard for me to understand. Now, as a rising ninth grader, I am more aware of the inequality that people in my community face. This year, in social studies, we learned about the Dred Scott decision, which stated that Black people weren't considered citizens of the United States. We've come a long way since the Dred Scott case, but judging from the last 3 years of political climate, we still have a long way to go. Learning about these current civil rights movements have made me feel angry about prejudices, but hopeful about progress we have made up until now. I am a boy with many privileges. I can walk around my town without any police stopping me, and I can walk to school without being scared of someone assuming I'm doing something wrong. If we are trying to achieve equality, then why are we still treating each other with such low quality? All of us should be treated with respect and freedom of judgment, no matter what the situation, our color, gender, or orientation. One of the aspects I love most about Renfroe is that is the diversity of the student community. Friends from different countries and cultures have taught me about their background and prepared me for the real world. The real world isn't made up of one race, one orientation, or one religion. It's made up of one humanity. My friend Isaiah is Black, my friend Hamid is Muslim, my friend Sean is Thai, and I'm Jewish. Our differences don't scare us away from each other. They bring us closer together as friends. If I moved on in life without being surrounded by diversity, I probably would be scared of meeting new people that look different from me. I greatly admire a high school friend named Royce Mann, who is a poet. In one of his poems titled White Boy Privilege, he says, "I have started life at the top of the ladder while you were born on the first rung." This made me realize, like Royce, I was born and built in advantages like my race and my gender. I hope in some way I can use my privileges to promote equality so that we can all end up on the same rung of the ladder. Here at Renfroe, I've met some of the best people who are bound to be lifelong friends. These people are of different colors, ethnicities, and orientations. I have learned that my true privilege is having these people as friends and a mother that only watches the news. Thank you.
Almost all of us have said or thought, something we've all felt at one time or another, something we like to say when it's raining and we have to walk to school, something we like to say when that teacher gave you 2 hours of homework, something we like to say when it's 12:01 a.m. and dang, you just missed the deadline, something I said when I first moved here. I had to come to this school with 1 year of middle school left. I had to leave the place I called home, the country I knew, the place where all my friends were, the place where I became the person I am today. And I had to come here, a place, a world, a country I knew nothing about and was completely uncomfortable in. I hated it. It was horrible. And all that I could think to say was, "I hate Decatur." I acted as if my own unhappiness came because I had to go to school every day, as if my sadness was spewing from the walls, as if leaving this school would solve all my problems. Looking back, I now realize I was wrong. And don't worry, I don't actually hate to hear that. When someone says to me they hate school, I look at them with the most perplexed stare. This place is not perfect. This place is far from it. But this place has given me a home for the past year. This place has given us all a chance. And I know it's so easy to blame the school for all the hardships and stress in your life. And I know we like to say, it's not me, it's the school. But wait a second. Take a look around. Look at everything. Look at what we have. And if you're rolling your eyes right now saying, wow, Mom, thanks for the lecture, let me tell you something. I'm speaking to myself as much as I am speaking to you. I attend this school named Renfroe. This place that gives computers and iPads to all their students. This place where every class has its own room and enough tables and chairs for all the kids. And although this may seem like nothing at all, this is a privilege that we have. But never think about it. This place that has a cafeteria to this place where the cafeteria has a warm lunch to serve to all of these kids. This place where every eighth grader has a locker and a computer and all the resources they need to succeed. This school where every day teachers give me new information to think and wonder about. Yes, sometimes it's repetitive and boring, but still, every day I sit there and I'm able to learn and think about all these new things. So when I was asked to write an essay about what I've learned during these past few years, I thought to myself, there's too much to choose from. I now realize that my unhappiness is not the school's fault. I was doing this to myself. Yeah, bad things can happen, but I can come back. And of course, I understand we all go through things. And I don't mean to tell you aren't allowed to be sad because of the privileges you have. I just wish people stopped complaining for a second and took it all in. I wish people could see just how amazing their lives are. But sadly, I know so many that are blind to it. So just think, the next time it's raining outside and you have to walk to school and that essay is due, we all know you didn't finish. Don't cry to your parents to stay home sick. Put your rain boots on and go dance in the rain. And know that even if it was a bad day, it's not a bad life. Thank you.
Turn around, and if you see my reflection in the snow.
most memorable part of that experience was seeing people wearing shorts throwing snowballs on each other. Like, where are their pants? Anyway, getting back on topic, Sydney, who is your hero?
My mother, whom I love dearly. She is so caring and loving. She would do anything for me and my sister. One of the reasons I recovered from health issues is because my mother and I have a relationship where I can tell her anything. When life gets tough, you can count on family.
That is hashtag mother-daughter goals.
Okay, now, who's the cringy one, Sophia?
Still you, sweetie. Let's now hear from students who honor the strength of their families. We'll hear from Riley Brimmer, Sophie Hart, Nashawn Smith, and Hannah Choi, followed by a spoken word poem by Lydia Witter.
My brother does not talk. He does not walk. He can't make precise movements with his hands, fingers, feet, or toes. My brother can't communicate the way we do. Most of us communicate by talking, texting, and other forms of communication. But my brother can't communicate through any of those. The only way my brother can communicate is through his feet. We ask him yes or no questions, and when he kicks his feet, he is saying yes. And when he doesn't kick his feet, he is saying no. My brother, Emerson, is the most inspiring person I know, and he is my main drive in life. He inspires me to do better in life. When I get a bad grade in school or an alternate good time in swimming, he pushes me to work harder. Whenever I have a bad day, I think about my brother. I think about how my day was, and then how much worse his might have been. I compare how many days I have had in my life to the amount that he might have had in his life. I'm almost positive that every day of his life has been a bad day in some way, shape, or form. Think about when you have an itch on your face and how you can just scratch it and it's gone. My brother can't do that. He just has to deal with the itch until it goes away naturally. Since my brother can't do half the things I can do, I try to be better at what I can do and not take my life for granted. I think that my brother would want me to be the best that I can be in the things I do. I strive to be the best that I can be in sports, school, piano, but sometimes I'm even too lazy to do those things. For example, I hate practicing the piano, but my brother loves it, so I try to continue to practice for him. Emerson pushes me forward in life. He has supported me in my life in ways that he might even know or understand. I would never be able to complete my everyday tasks if I didn't have my brother backing me up. I would never have gotten this far in life if I didn't have my brother supporting me along the way. I think that my brother enjoys everything that I do, and I think that he wishes he could do those things. I don't feel like I support my brother enough in the things he does, and I hope that someday I will be able to support him in the way that I want to. Thank you.
Way too much. I have a great group of friends, you know, school stuff. But what if I told you that it took me 2 hours to get to school every morning? What if I told you there were days I didn't know where I was going to sleep? What if I told you I was homeless? Before I moved here, I lived on a 9-acre farm with lots of animals and things to do, but then we had to move to Decatur, which is obviously a very different environment. We settled into a small house and everything was going well until we discovered that my mom had developed an illness and had to go into emergency surgery. Medical costs began to pile up. We knew that we had to move. After a few months of staying in a small apartment, we knew that we had to move again, but this time we had nowhere to go. Soon enough, we were homeless. When I say I was homeless, it probably isn't what you're expecting. It usually comes as a surprise to people that I never stayed in a shelter or in the streets. This may lead to some questions. Luckily, I'm answering some of those questions today. From September of 7th grade to October of 8th grade, I stayed in over 16 different places due to homelessness, including hotels, campsites, cars, abandoned houses, and friends' houses. Some days it was easier to find a place to stay, but most times it wasn't. A lot of the time, we had no idea where we were going to sleep. Another major setback that we faced was getting transportation, mostly to and from school. Our car was unreliable at the time, so we were forced to find another way to get to school and back. I remember that I would tell my friends that I just liked going to the coffee shop after school, when in reality my sister and I would wait there a few hours, either waiting for my mom or Uber to come pick us up. Getting to school was really difficult for us too. At one point, we had to stay about 2 hours away from Decatur. So every morning, my mom, my sister, and I would all wake up at 5 a.m. and have to leave at 6 a.m. in order to beat morning traffic. But that was only if we had a working car. If we didn't, we'd have to get a ride service, which was really hard because we were basically staying in the middle of nowhere. And even if we got a ride, it was about a $50 trip to Decatur. The biggest obstacle that my sister and I faced was school. On top of all the stress at home, we had to get assignments done, which wasn't easy because we rarely had a place to do schoolwork. There was also a lot of anxiety about coming to school. I remember being so scared to come to school after I hadn't been there because I was so terrified about what I would say, what my next excuse would be. That's the main reason I'm so thankful to be here telling my story, because I don't have to be afraid anymore. I know that my experience probably sounds completely awful, but I don't think that's true. I know that I wouldn't be who I am today if I hadn't gone through what I did. Not only was I able to become more resourceful and really see what I was capable of, I was able to see so many amazing people come forward and teach me that someone is always willing to help no matter what. Thank you.
Middle school for me was like walking into a world of mistakes. Define mistakes. They are unavoidable subjects that humans experience every day, and apparently what I specialize in. If I could get a dollar for every time I made a mistake, I would feel this thing worse right now. I'm talking $1,000 an hour. I've messed up so many times, whether it be family, relationships, friendships, or anything you could possibly think of, I've had at least one fault. All these mistakes and failures really caused me to just give everything up. I was at the point where I just didn't care anymore. It didn't matter to me. I felt like I was in a dark hole, blind to everything in front of me. And the more I tried to get out, the worse it got. For example, this year I had a large schedule and I didn't balance it very well. I was in the club called Renfroe Gyms. I had meetings for a scholarship that I got nominated for, wrestling practice, football workouts, etc. But instead of trying to come up with ways to balance my schedule, I just skipped some and go to the other without notifying anyone. And that was one of the largest mistakes I ever made. It only made people frustrated and angry with me, and eventually overwhelmed me. Life is such a pain. I got to the point where I didn't even try to escape that dark hole anymore, like I lived in. Thankfully, I had very important people in my life that helped me. My uncle was one of those people. He always told me how we were similar when we were children, and how he made lots of mistakes as well. But one of the main things that stuck out to me was when he told me the difference in between us. He told me that I have people to guide and help me when I'm having problems, and I need to take that to my advantage. He also told me that just because he's giving me a pep talk about how mistakes were being fine, doesn't mean I should go make mistakes purposely, because then they're not mistakes anymore. He told me that I should reflect on them and think about them. So I did. I looked back and thought about what I did and what I should have done differently so that I won't make the same mistake in the future. And I ended up just learning from my mistakes. That's when it hit me. Everything happens for a reason. Every thought I have, action I make, sentence I say, has a purpose. As Albert Einstein said, a person who never made a mistake never tried anything new. So mistakes do serve a purpose in this world. It taught me a lot of things, it helped me to make better choices, and they also kind of prepared me for the future. So continue to make mistakes, and don't stress over them. Sometimes they have great outcomes. It's how you deal with them that counts.
has ever stayed the same. Hardly anything remains constant. Still, everyone is afraid of the unknown. This is why many people struggle to accept change. When people do not understand something, they will create a reason or explanation for it. However, sometimes people manufacture baseless and fictional concepts to explain life. And during painful situations, it is detrimental. Still, no matter the circumstances, everyone needs to know how to accept change. The uncertainty and fear of not knowing what happens next plagues everyone's life at some point. Over this past year, I felt like I've been trapped in a downward spiral. My father was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer last spring. The events which occurred since then were unpredictable. Life will not go as planned. People experience rejection, loss, or disappointment every day. Yet people despise change. Our world is constantly adapting and developing. It feels like if you're not prepared, you get left behind. People need to grow at their own pace, but if you stay the same, what is your value as a person? Without change, there's nothing left for us. My father taught me that our lives should never fall stagnant, no matter how safe that may feel. I've also heard the phrase, everything happens for a reason. Reasons are supposed to reveal why things are the way they are. People find security in the how and why. Nonetheless, I hate it when people say everything happens for a reason. When my father was diagnosed with cancer, I didn't know why. Nobody in my family did. It just happened, spontaneously. During the past year leading up to his death, I realized how truly damaging the concept is. It's an appalling mindset to promote, especially for people who are tearing apart at the seams. Telling people that every scenario can be explained and only encourages them to wonder what brought upon their suffering. The phrase nurtures the idea that bad events are consequences. It leads people yearning to know what they did wrong and puts them into a degrading mentality. Many people may know the importance of accepting change, but they fall short in actually accepting it. The last year, my dad's life was filled with friends, family, and community. There were always people who were willing to support me, my brothers, and my parents. I missed 2 weeks of school leading up to the days my father died. When it was time to go back to school, I didn't think I was ready. Upon actually returning to classes, I immediately felt overwhelmed. I was spreading myself thin, catching up on 2 weeks of missed content within days. Everyone had just moved on without me. Except there were people who waited. No matter how suffocating my life felt, I had multiple friends who were insistent on helping me or making me smile. I realized that during a time of need, you will find people who will walk with you, and it makes everything so much easier. People get caught up in finding reasons, but they never find closure. They end up hurting themselves or others in the process. Still, this resentment is considered normal, but in actuality, it is so dangerous and harmful. When someone is dying, you lose all control. It is happening, and it feels awful because there's nothing you can do but wait. You can be angry, upset, or sad. You can cry and scream, but you should never ask yourself why. There's nothing that leads me to believe that my dad, or any cancer patient for that matter, did anything to deserve to die. There is no reason, because nobody did anything to justify suffering. Change is inevitable, but those words don't have to be so frightening anymore. Thank you.
After me, the lifespan of 21 fireflies who lived and died and glowed while I was none the wiser waiting. For brother, I didn't know would ever exist to live and love and grow and cry whenever the dog died on the silver screen. Who teach you more than I could ever know, who ran without mittens in the snow, cold and laughing, he keeps my secrets in a lockbox in his heart, and he threw away the key in the recesses of his brain where memories and dreams have wisdom to impart. So they wrestle and they fight and you never know who will win. He is so quiet that when he shouts, you have to listen, because whatever he says, it has to matter. But he is so, so quiet that I have learned to shout for him.
and raise my voice even if I don't want to. Where I am cold, he is kind. Where I hide, he keeps me company. My brother who lets me paint his nails because I want to, and he would do anything for me. My brother who I show every beautiful thing I see because when he sees beauty, the world is golden and glowing with the first rays of light that peek over the horizon at sunrise. When the world was dark, he was a light, guiding me on because I could never have a heart like his, but it was something to strive for. And when he thought there was no purpose to anything, I suffered too, and when he suffered, so did I, and I wanted to be a wall for him to lean on, a shoulder to cry on, a pedestal to lift him to his rightful place above the clouds. And when other people look up to their heroes, the ones who won wars and stood up in the face of everything wrong with the world, I look to my right to find my own hero, sitting on a rolling chair and listening to my hopes, my fears, my dreams, my tears. He was the firefly that led me through the fields and meadows, through dales and creeks and streets and highways. And I know that when I don't know, he does. And when he doesn't know, I can tell him. When I was 11, I didn't know why I was or what I was or where I could go. And he doesn't either. But when he goes into middle school and walks the halls I once roamed, I want him to know that I can be his rock, sturdy in the face of adversity, a worried warrior trying to win for him. I want him to say that his older sister was born 108,345,600 seconds before him, and that she has been there for him, that I have been a firefly, guiding him through the darkness like he has been for me. Thank you.
Thank you.
song helps us remember to be there for each other in times of need, which, unfortunately, has been necessary this year.
Sonder is one of my favorite words. Sonder is the feeling when you recognize that each person you meet has a complex life, much like your own. Most people don't think about it much, but I do. I learned this word about 2 years ago, and it gives me a new perspective. It forced me to remember that everyone's going through something. Anxiety, depression, financial issues, low self-esteem, friendship or family problems, among countless other things. I believe that as a society, we often forget that each person's life is just as complex as our own. We feel as though people only exist as they do for you.
This year, we lost a member of our community, Shakia Ward Reese. Here to honor her memory are her friends, Sequoia Dudley, Emma Lagan, Kanan Muhammad, and Myra Phelps.
Morning, March 25th.
When I heard the news, my heart dropped.
My world was sucked into a vacuum.
Plans made, voices speaking, dogs barking, time ticking.
The world simply stopped.
In the Chinese tradition, life is seen as a balance.
Like between the sun and the rain.
Yin and yang.
Khalil Gibran teaches the joy and the sorrow of the prophet.
He says the deeper the sorrow carves into your being, the more joy you can contain.
When your joy is look deep into your heart and you will find it's only because you have felt sorrow that you are able to recognize joy.
And when you're sorrowful, look again in your heart. You shall see that actually you are weeping for the joy that you've experienced.
Joy is greater than sorrow.
No, sorrow is greater than joy.
No, they are inseparable. Together they come, and when one sits alone with you at your work, the other is asleep at your bed.
We are suspended like scales between our sorrow and joy.
We all have that one friend where if they didn't come to school, it made the whole day bad.
Remember when she would run down the hallway and just start to dance and twerk like nobody was watching?
And bust out laughing.
She wasn't just any old friend. She was a friend I could talk about anything to.
She made lunch so fun. She was the kind of friend you could just laugh about the goofiest things with.
Like her top secret request, they always made me laugh.
Every morning, I would go to annoy her, because she'd get the best reactions to the jokes I made. Like, didn't you hear a joke about pizza? Oh wait, it's too cheesy. Exactly.
Or the way she would say, Emma girl.
And Lord, she loved to eat.
She was always asking for my snacks. If she wasn't either dancing or eating,
we knew something was wrong. But she didn't tell us that something was wrong.
That she needed help.
And now, instead of laughing and dancing on the walls, we are minus one.
Silence, as we wait for the news to come on.
Silence, as we wait for those who love her to finish her eulogy.
Silence, in our hallways, as we notice she is no longer with us.
Silence, as we mourn the loss of Shakia Ward Reese.
Please. If you earn over your head, ask for help.
Cherish every moment you have to be with your friends and family and tell them that you love them every chance that you get.
When unthinkable things happen, you'll find out who your real friends are.
If you didn't have joy, you can't appreciate the sorrow. Without sorrow, there can be no joy.
Shakia, the joy you brought to us is alive in our sorrow.
And the sorrow we feel for your passing helps us remember the joy you gave to us.
Your friends, your family, your world.
Long live Shakia.
Sometimes we cannot see heroes around us until we see one in ourselves.
My superhero wasn't born with laser vision and super strength. I had to be trained. I had to condition myself not to overanalyze and to find strategies that could help. I saw my social anxiety as a curse, But as I worked to understand it, I uncovered details about myself as a person. I began to see the hero in myself.
I mean, I get it. I've struggled with self-esteem problems. Throughout the last 3 years, I've had periods where I love myself in a completely non-narcissistic way, and periods where I haven't been comfortable with who I am. I had to overcome negative thoughts about my teeth prior to my braces, my skin tone, and how skinny I am, along with countless other things. I've actually learned to love all the things that I previously hated about myself.
I know what you mean about learning to love the tender things about yourself that others point out. I noticed that by working through my problems, I realized prioritizing my needs isn't selfish, it's self-care. Social anxiety was my hero because she taught me that in our weakness, there's something admirable. She could have brought me down, but instead, with the help of supportive peers, parents, and teachers, my social anxiety was something that helped me understand a little bit of who I am as a person. The real hero is one who struggles and overcomes.
Next, we will hear a spoken word poem by Jesse Montgomery and speeches from Sophia Holland, Molly Solon, Sarah Yates, and Oliver Wood.
Why can't I do this? Why am I asking these questions? I make a mistake, I don't get something first try, and it floods. It wells until it reaches my eyes, and all they want to do is drain it out. The moment pools and leaks into each crevice of my brain and body, and it's all I can think about. Thought you were smart. Thought you were good at this. I thought you knew what you were doing. I think and think and think and think and think, and I think I need to stop. And breathe. In the oxygen comes, I am resuscitated. The flood has passed, yet I remain soaked. I make the mistake and try again and again and again and breathe because it turns out okay. It always does. I make the time, I make the grave, but I make the mistake and that's all it takes to make the day. I'm sitting in class and I've just finished reading the novel about a girl who makes mistakes in this mistaken world, and I think I'll write my essay about the same mistaken world 80 years later. But this world has so many imperfections and I don't know which one to choose, and over the next few days I think I pick out just the perfect one, the perfect way. So I search for validation from my teacher, but her guidance only slightly changes the careful plans I've made. And they will help me grow oh so tall, but for now it's all been torn apart. And I've shrunk into myself because I need to know if it's okay, if I'm okay, and oh, I can feel the blood starting. And I sit for the rest of class without writing a single word because I can't let my eyes drain in front of everyone here. Oh no, but now it's time to go, and I open the floodgates, I mean the door. And it all comes spilling out. Down. I find myself comforted by someone I hardly know, and I think this mistaken world might still be okay. And she tells me, it's okay, I'm okay, it's all fine, and it will turn out okay, because it always does. And it does. It's Saturday before the race, and I hear the gun, and I run and run and run and run, and I cross that line, but my finish time is not enough. It's enough for them, so why isn't it enough for me? I don't know. All I know, all I think is how awful, how terrible. This was it, this was it all, and I start to fall and fall and fall and fall into the water below. And it starts to flood, and I think I'm drowning, and this story doesn't have an ending. It doesn't turn out okay, yet. But it will, I know, because it always does, one way or another. And it took a few days, but I no longer think I'm drowning. It's so easy to sink into the flood, the doubt. We're all just trying to keep afloat. And it's so easy not to forgive ourselves for slipping and falling into the chasm. We struggle for a long time under the rapids, but we find a raft and escape the doubt, and it will be okay. I will be okay. We will be okay and the flood will pass because it always does. Thank you.
My voice, one in 7.6 billion voices in the world, and one in 1,270 voices at Renfroe Middle School. If someone were to ask me how I could use that voice to make an impact on a national issue 3 years ago, I would have told them that it's not possible. That one number being the only reason I didn't even try. I felt as though my voice was a grain of sand at the bottom of a sea of sharks that I knew would be drowned out by the sound of the crashing waves. What I did not realize then was the strength that each one of our powerful voices have when we come together. I guess you could say that I underestimated the power of our Renfroe Middle School sandcastle. Coming into middle school, I felt as though I was powerless. There was no point in trying to enact change because I knew that no one was listening. My small hum was nothing compared to the screaming voices of the world. Flipping through the channels on TV, reading the textbooks, even lifting my head up and looking around, I saw so many powerful people. Each one of them were so different, yet so inspiring, because they all had a goal that they were driven to reach. They had an opinion and a voice that they were not afraid to use. Not only did they all have strong voices, but they all had an intention to use them to make a bold statement. Through learning the power that I have as an individual, I've also learned that my voice is nothing if I do not use it every chance that I get to make a difference. Asking yourself how you are going to use your voice to make a change, whether that be tomorrow or in the next year. Asking yourself how someone's life is going to be changed in the best way possible by the way that you choose to use your voice is so important. March 14, 2018, a day that so many of us came together to demand change. By combining each strong voice at Renfroe Middle School that day, we were able to change lives and open eyes to what we were marching for. Looking around in the midst of it all, I saw nothing but diversity. Not a single voice shouted the same or had the same story behind it, and that was the beauty of it. Our ability to come together as a school and as a community to speak our minds was so powerful. Since that day, I have not once underestimated the power that my or our voices have. Since that day, I have held posters, I've marched, and I've used my voice every chance that I've gotten to leave my footprint on this world. As we all start to find our voices moving into high school, as we all find exactly where we belong in this growing sandcastle, I encourage you to ask yourself how your grain of sand is going to keep the castle from falling over. Ask yourself, what are you going to do with your voice?
When I try to remember my first day at Renfroe, my memories show me a little girl. A child with wide, scared eyes who tried not to look at people. I don't think about that little girl often. In my fast-paced world, there isn't time to think about the past. That's why I had to stop and wonder just how that little girl grew into me. I moved from Northern Virginia to Decatur on August 1st of 2016. That was the day my father signed the final sale contract on our new house, and that was my first day in seventh grade. I had come in the front entrance, clutching my agenda with two hands in front of my face. When I stumbled into my homeroom class, students were laughing and chattering with the friends they hadn't seen all summer. Most stopped when I entered and looked blankly at me. I was sitting alone at a table when another student walked in. She made her way over to my table. "My name's Tanya," I remember her saying as she stuck out her hand. "Are you new?" Tanya Jane quickly became one of my closest friends during seventh grade. However, Tanya left at the beginning of our eighth grade year. In her absence at Renfroe, frankly, did not leave a gaping hole. Because while she meant absolutely the world to me, she was just another face in the crowd to practically everybody else. She had a quirky fashion and she was Republican. And for many students, that was all they needed to know and that's all they ever knew about Tanya. As I slowly became reconciled to the absence of my dearest friend, I began to think more about the significance of what I was observing. How could the way I saw Tanya and the way the person next to me saw Tanya have been so acutely and startlingly different that I chose to befriend her and the person next to me chose to keep her distance? Is that what judgment has become? Something that doesn't just taint your image of someone but distorts your entire perception of them? When I realized this, I knew I had to break free. The way I saw people couldn't be trusted because I view people from the same criterion people view Tanya, from physical features and their fashion choices. This realization disgusted me. How many people have lost a friend in Tanya by judging her too quickly? How many friends have I lost from my wrong judgments? So I struggled to change. I really did. I no longer had a haven of kindness, and it was time for me to meet new people and meet them unconditionally. Because of this, the last half of my eighth grade year took a distinct upwards turn, and I'm happy to say I know who I am, and I know how I will always strive to see others. Because I began to look at people more openly, I began to start respecting the features that made me mean, and began to love myself more. Before I close, it is important for me to say I almost didn't read this essay. I almost forgot the moral that I'm delivering to you right now, and let my harsh judgments and self-conscious dictate my willingness to read. I was again blinded by the judgment which grips our world, but please let the proof that I'm standing before you today let you know that all judgment can be overcome. And even in the darkest places and most difficult times, keep your mind open and an empathetic heart. Thank you.
I realized that I had several goals in life, and there were several things that were keeping me from reaching those goals. By several things, I mean everybody else in the world. I decided that people existed purely to get in my way. Fortunately, just when I was getting used to that mindset, a few irritatingly persistent people convinced me otherwise. In sixth grade, we were assigned the task of making a model of some technology that inspired us, complete with a poster containing information about that technology. Other people had lovely projects, including a cardboard typewriter and a ping-pong-playing robot made out of PVC pipes. I stuck some toothpicks to some string and called it a bridge. A Google search of famous bridges resulted in the Hanging Bridges of Costa Rica, so I wrote that on a sticky note, which I adhered to my masterpiece. When I was called up to explain my project, I sauntered up to the front of the class, held up my model, and smiled. I stood there for at least 20 seconds. Saying nothing, trying not to look at my friends who were covering their mouths in feeble attempts to conceal their laughter. Eventually, my teacher, seeing that I needed some prompting, asked me to share a bit about my model. So I cleared my throat and proclaimed, "This is a hanging bridge of Costa Rica!" My model chose this moment to fall apart, leaving me clinging to a single toothpick. And my sticky note. I mean, thank goodness. My teacher's face was screaming his desire for retirement. He asked me if I had done any research, and I saw my light flash in front of my eyes. So I spit out the only thing my 11-year-old brain could produce. Yes, I found several articles. Unfortunately, they were all in Spanish. In case you're wondering, I recently looked up Hanging Bridges of Costa Rica. There were 11 million results in English. Just then, I heard some choking noises come from my teacher's desk, so I turned around ready to administer the Heimlich, but I didn't mean to. He was laughing. I like to think he was laughing with me, not at me. He gestured for me to come up to his desk and asked if I had a poster. I held up my sticky note. A week later, a friend texted me saying that the grades were on manage back. I felt my stomach sink to my knees. I got an 8 on that project. Along with that grade, I realized that I got people dead wrong. I've learned that people aren't obstacles. People aren't objects that I have to push aside. Actually, they're the opposite. Back in sixth grade, I completely misjudged my situation. I saw my teacher as the obstacle when the real problem was my inability to construct a toothpick bridge. In reality, my teacher was the solution, not the problem. In fact, when I think about the last 3 years of my life, reflecting on what made me who I am today and how I overcame obstacles, it was the people. It was always the people. The people who came up and introduced themselves on that first day, who offered to be my partner on a group project, who sat by me when I was crying, or who showed that they cared. They were never in my way. They were never obstacles. They were individuals who cared enough to help me. I've learned that there will always be people who seem to exist to keep you from reaching your goals. But there will also be people who help you get there, in so many ways. So, I honestly hope that you come to that same realization, because it's made me who I am today. And, by the way, thanks for everything.
People like me can spend hours waiting for that perfect moment. that moment where the kid sitting across the room says that the largest fish in the world is a blue whale. That moment is the peak of a euphoric mountain. A mountain which I will conquer when I deliver salvation. When I inevitably reply with, well, actually, whales are mammals because they're warm-blooded and produce milk. That's usually the highlight of my day. Until, of course, I start losing friends over it. But then, was it intelligent to correct the person? Throughout the majority of my middle school years, my answer would have been yes. But looking back on it now, my answer is no. I've certainly changed a lot throughout my middle school years. I've changed my beliefs over the course of many world events, and I've improved my social skills and am generally better at talking to people. But one area I still struggle in is my tendency to brag or to show off. I used to take pride in knowing that I could memorize one more fact or that I had a slightly higher grade than the other students in my class. In one instance, I started comparing my math grades to a certain girl whenever I used to pass her in the hallways. In another, right after a test, I compared my grades to one of my best friends. Now, in these instances, I wasn't bragging up front, but the message was still there. They didn't talk to me for the rest of the day. Now, after that, I started trying to act more humble. I realized the reason why I and many other people brag was to get attention. We wanted other people to give us the confirmation that we could not give ourselves. But the bottom line is, nobody cares if you got 4 more points on a test. Nobody cares if you got a slightly higher grade than they did. By bragging, all I did was push people away from me. And if I were to have done it anymore, there would have been no friends left to hear. By bragging, I was reliant on a statistic, reliant on others, reliant on them to give me confirmation. But in truth, I only needed my own confirmation. Now I know for some of you, it might be difficult to accept that there is no guaranteed method of measuring success. But everyone needs to realize that the tests we take do not represent us. The approval of others do not represent us. And that might sound confusing to some of you, but that's just how this world functions. Life can be confusing, and it's nice to have a roadmap to guide us through our journey. But sometimes, the only person who can determine your success is you.
In school, we all use the terminology smart people.
There's a specific amount of people in the school who we just classify as smart. And majority of the time, I was considered a part of that crowd, according to my teachers as well as peers. It's astonishing to see how much confidence everyone else has in you. But you just don't feel that way about yourself, you know? I have the grades to prove I'm a knowledgeable student, but my inner confidence just didn't match. My support team is freaking amazing. Before heading to school every morning, I see words of encouragement that my mom has displayed in my bathroom on the mirror. They read, "You are perfect, just the way you are. Your black is gorgeous. Your mom loves you." And the words go on and on. Gradually, I discovered a plethora of various attributes about myself. It's astonishing to look back at my sixth grade self and visually see who I am now. I had to eventually realize that no one's holding me back from my full potential. It was me all along. Through the year, I've been awarded the Coretta Scott King Award, been acknowledged for a scholarship, and placed first in overall in some of the top dance competitions in the world. Today, I stand before you graduating the eighth grade and completing my middle school chapter. It's been a lot of stressful nights where we all just felt like giving up. There's been a few nights where I've said to myself, I wonder if quitting the eighth grade is really a thing. But that wasn't what God had brought me on this earth to do. I was created to be great. I was created to stand out from the rest. I was created to change someone's life. That's my calling. We are all creating new chapters in our books for high school. We all have the potential. We are all beginning scholars. We all have the potential to become heroes. There are multiple pathways we can choose to go after leaving Renfroe. Some of us may not be attending Decatur High, but we can all take away the new knowledge I've shared about creating new and better selves. I want you all to take with you the following quote that has truly gotten me through this year. Throw me to the wolves, and I'll come back leading the pack. Know that your words have volume and speak power. Whatever challenges you may face throughout your upcoming year as entering high school, just know that you are so much more powerful than you think. In the same song, India R.A. sang, "Lay down your regrets, because all we have is now. All we have is now." So let's make it count and become the unlikely heroes of tomorrow. No matter where we are or where we go, we'll always continue to rock that blue and gold pride. Thank you, everyone.
Ceremony, Sophie and Sid. And just one more self-indulgent hand for the 8th grade teachers and staff. Yeah, they put in a lot of hours in planning the logistics of this event, but I hope you noticed that from the reading of the names until, well, I'm here, this was a total student-driven show. So that's really cool. So, Decatur High School Class of 2022. I am really, truly humbled by the level of talent that is on this floor today. However, I think you've just about reached your limits for keeping it together for an hour and a half. So I am going to keep this incredibly brief. I've only been your principal for about 4 months, but they have been the most rewarding 4 months of my career. Thank you so much for welcoming me into your family. I hope you all have a great summer. I hope you're looking forward to Decatur High, because it is a great school to go to. I hope you enjoy the rest of the afternoon with your family and friends. I really hope that you do not find your way back to our campus during dismissal today. I'm serious. Parents, thank you so much for doing everything you did to support your kids through those middle school years. Thank you. This is the end of our program, so I'm going to turn into like logistic-y principal mode for a second, so bear with me. For the next 5 seconds, I want kids and parents to go ahead and make eye contact with one another. Okay. So here's the deal. Students that are heading back to Renfroe are going to meet Miss Caribly over in that corner. Students whose last names begin with A through M, but not yet. I'll tell you when. Students with last names A through M will make their way up these stairs and connect with your loved ones along this walkway out here. Parents of students from N to Z, once those A through Mers get up there, the parents from N to Z families are going to make their way down and connect with your loved ones down here. It seems really good on paper, but let's just see how it goes. Enjoy your afternoon with your kiddos. They are all